alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Today we're going to be doing the 40th hadith from the 40 Nawawi hadith. Now it's really important to mention that the 40 hadith, the 40 Nawawi hadith, are not actually 40. They're actually 42 hadith. But in Arabic, they may say alfiya or 1,000 to actually mean close to 1,000, whether less, a little less, or more. But in the end, it's around 40-ish. You had some scholars that did actually add 8 more, like Ibn Rajab. You had other scholars that added 10 more or different numbers. But in the end, they're actually around 40. So the hadith goes as follows. عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال أخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمنكبي فقال كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر سبيل. وكان ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما يقول إذا أمسيت فلا تنتظر الصباح وإذا أصبحت فلا تنتظر المساء وخذ من صحتك لمرضك ومن حياتك لموتك. رواه البخاري. Now you could see there are two things here. Number one is that there's the athar and there's the hadith. The athar is basically what Abdullah ibn Umar said. That's the athar. Alright? I was supposed to say aw'abiru sabil, not aw'abiru sabil. Alright? So there's the hadith. The hadith is basically what the Prophet ﷺ had narrated or said. And the athar is what the Sahabi had actually said. So the quote that the Sahabi had said, that's the athar. Let me write that down for you. So an athar, that's why you would have certain books that are just specialized in combining and collecting al-athar, just like Musannif ibn Abd al-Razzaq and Musannif ibn Abi Shayba. Those are specialized in just collecting al-athar, not al-ahadith. Al-ahadith are basically what was said by the Prophet ﷺ himself. An ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, Ibn Umar is basically the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the famous Umar ibn al-Khattab, that's his son. Alright, so Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, he died at 73 Hijriya. He was born 10 years before Hijrah. In other words, he was 10 or 11 years old when they had migrated to Medina. So Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, he was one of the most important Sahaba. In fact, he was expected to be a Khalifa after his father, but his father, Umar ibn al-Khattab, said that kafa al-Khattabi, so it is enough for al-Khattab to have sins, the sins of being in positions of responsibility and political responsibility. So he said, you know, kafa al-Khattabi, the word was sins. Kafa al, it's enough for al-Khattab, like the family of al-Khattab, they have enough sins. And Abdullah ibn Umar al-Khattab was, because he was a young boy when the Prophet was in Medina, so Abdullah ibn Umar al-Khattab happens to be one of fuqaha al-sahaba, one of the sahaba that were actually scholars in fiqh. And he was also a muhaddith. Muhaddith would mean he was a scholar in hadith. And of course, Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab was one of the most important sahaba in imitating the Prophet ﷺ. He was also known to be in the sahabi, to be in the sahabi that was a very zahid sahabi, a sahabi that had he wasn't holding on to dunya, he was more holding on to al-akhirah. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab actually participated in a number of different battles with the Prophet ﷺ, including the different battles when it was against the Byzantine Empire in Isham, in Bilad al-Sham, the Levant, and also Iraq against the Persians, and of course the different Iran and the whole kingdom of Persia, and was also one of the people that participated in opening Egypt as well with Amr ibn al-As. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Of course, he was originally from Mecca that later migrated to Medina. So I'm not going to go in talking a lot about Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. And we're going to go to the hadith. So the hadith actually says, أَخَذَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِمِنْكَبِي. So that was Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. He actually said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he put his hand on Abdullah ibn Umar's shoulders. And this is really important. You know, when you're teaching somebody and you put your hand on their shoulder or probably on their back, it makes a different connection. And that's what the Prophet said. He was very humble. And he was, in fact, there was one of the nasiha that the Prophet actually says that what a great man Abdullah would be if only he were to do Qiyam al-Layl. If he was doing Qiyam al-Layl, he would be an exceptional person. So what did he do? So he says the Prophet ﷺ held him by his shoulders. It was a very nice, it was a teacher's grasp. It was a teacher's cuddle. You would want to say the Prophet ﷺ put his hand on Abdullah ibn Umar's shoulder and he says, Kun fi dunya ka'annaka gharib. Kun means be in this dunya, الدنيا, in this life. كأنك غريب, as if you are a stranger. That's not your final destination. غريب, أو عابر سبيل, or a person that is just passing by. A person that's just passing by. أو عابر سبيل, or a person that is not living there forever, just walking by. Or, of course, when we say, what's the difference between gharib and abir sabil? Gharib, you can be a stranger and still decide to reside in that place. But abir sabil, you don't plan to stay in that place at all. You're just passing by. You have a different destination and you're just walking through a certain city or going through a certain city. That's the difference between abir sabil and gharib. And, of course, ka'annaka gharib is going to be of a lesser level than Abir Sabil, because Gharib, you know, you're still a stranger in that area, but you're planning probably to reside. Maybe you're planning to stay here a longer period of time. But at the end, Kun fi dunya ka'annaka gharib is really the Prophet's advice. And in Nawawi, you could see that he mentioned this hadith when he was closer to the end of that book. And the reason for it is because after giving you all the different rulings and letting you know all the different things about Islam, he basically said, you know, at the end, be mindful that this life, there's going to be an ending to it. So don't prepare for your dunya as if you're going to be staying here forever. Be mindful that you are actually living in this dunya for just a short stay. If you can't be as if you are gharib, as if you're a stranger and where you're not keeping everything, so you're just trying to, as much as you can, learn some things and move on. Well, if you can even go farther in your level, عابر سبيل. عابر سبيل, you're just passing by. The difference is that when you're عابر سبيل, when you're just passing by, you're not really paying attention. You're not focused on collecting things because you know very well there's not much that you can carry. And of course, when you have, weight that you have to be considerate of, and there are different things, when you're going on a journey, you're always trying to take the most important things in order to move on. And that's it. You don't want to take and carry extra things because they will be keeping you back. they will be holding you back. And instead of you achieving to get to your destination, you will be more concerned about the things and the items you're carrying. And this we know very well. So when you're traveling, make sure you don't carry too many of those small details, because they might get lost. If they don't get lost, you might get lost trying to be mindful of those little tiny things here and there. And not to mention that, you know, the tiny details, they may be tiny, but those details, the more details you take along with you, the more likely that you will be getting heavier. In other words, your luggages, your baggages, etc., they're going to be get heavier, and most likely they're just going to be an extra weight and a heavy load and a big load on your back, and probably even keeping you even more tired as you go and as you are on your journey. And that's the same thing. Abir sabil, in where you're taking the most important things, and those things are basically the deeds in order to get to the Akhirah. You know, our life is short. Our life is short. And we usually live in long hopes that I'm going to get a degree, I'm going to get married, I'm going to get kids, I'm going to get my kids married, buy a house. And we live with all these hopes that only if I had a house, only if I had a car, only if it's going to make my life different. But we rarely recognize and realize that a lot of these people that are actually under those graves, they thought as well, just like us, thinking that if only I had a home, or if only I had such and such. But then we realize, and many times, that it's too late. We realize that that was not what our life was intended for. All those different things that you have in life, whether it's a degree, whether it's marriage, children, house, whatever it is, those are tools for happiness, but that is not the ultimate and the real happiness. This is just a tool to get you to be able to live an easy life, to be able to fulfill the main purpose of your life for al-akhirah. Aabiru sabil, and this is aabiru sabil. It's really important to mention that when Umar ibn al-Khattab, you know, he learns this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself, you know, teaches us how did he understand what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told him? How did he put it into practice? You know, it's really easy to put words that may be too comprehensive. How do we put that into practice? How do we put it into and implement it in our life? So Umar ibn al-Abdullah actually says, إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَاحِ. If you go into your night, don't expect, in other words, don't procrastinate till morning. If you want to do Qiyam al-Layl now, do it now. Don't wait in a couple of hours. You might not wake up. If you decide that you want to do your hifz, don't say when I finish this or I finish that. That day might not even come. If you look at all those that died before us, they were all wondering and they were all thinking, if only I could just finish this or that task. And all those that had died, they always had a lot of tasks that they had on their schedule, but the death came right before their schedule was ever completed, or their tasks were ever completed. And that's why there's nothing closer in your, or nothing closer or sooner or even more likely to be on your schedule than death, because it comes unexpectedly. It comes to you when you least expect it. إذا أمسيت فلا تنتظر الصباح. If you're in night, don't wait and procrastinate and say that I'll wait till morning. If you want to do a good deed, do it now. وإذا أصبحت فلا تنتظر المساء. And if you go in morning time, don't procrastinate until nighttime or until night falls. Don't do that because you might never make it. وَخُذْ مِنْ صِحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ. And this is especially, I would like to say it, although it includes men and women, but I would like to emphasize this one as much as I can. وَخُذْ مِنْ صِحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ. And take, and in other words, take advantage and make use of those times that you are healthy, because you might not be able to do it when you are ill. And from that, I would like to tell the sisters, if you have the time, and especially the sisters, if you have the time to do your studying, your hifadh, your good hasanat, your qiyam al-layl, don't wait till you get married. Because I'll tell you, when you get married, things will start accumulating and your schedule will start getting harder and harder by the day. When we look at, for example, especially a woman's life and where she goes through different moments of pains, different moments of loads, whether it's pregnancy, nursing, or even her monthly cycle, a lot of those hardships, they basically take a lot of her focus away. What they were telling us was morning sickness is not morning sickness, but it could be an all-day sickness for maybe 15 weeks, and for some women, it's a whole 9 months. And even after she gets the baby, for 2 months, she's going to be nursing almost every 2 hours, not getting enough sleep and not getting enough time for her rest, or even enough time to just get a moment to just rest. And that's why I would always tell the sisters, as much as you can, use and take advantage of the time that you have now, because it might not come again. Whether it's your health, whether it's your time, or even if it's your money. Same thing for the men as well. If you have the time now to do things, if you're 15, you're 16, you're 19, 20, 25, don't say, I'll start making my hifz when I'm 30 or when I'm 40, because by then your body, your memory is not going to be the same when you're younger. Your capacity, your time is not going to be the same. Now is better than tomorrow. Now is definitely better, because once you procrastinate, that tomorrow might not even come. You know, one beautiful thing is that if you had the intention, let's say you said, I've got the intention, I'm going to memorize the Quran. And you said, here's my schedule. You put the schedule and you say, this is what I'm going to do as my daily schedule to memorize this much. And I'm going to review this much, etc. But then on that day, you actually died. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will actually decree, or will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will write it for you, depending on your intention. If you had the sincerity and you had the determination that that's what you're going to do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put it for you as if you had actually completed the task. Put in the task. Put it as part of your schedule. Put in that determination, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the reward even if you did not complete the task. وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. And take from your life, take the advantage of your life before it's too late, and you end up being part of those that once lived. And this is really important to mention, because without us realizing, it is just a short period of time and we may not realize it. You've got a blessing right now. If you're able to get up and walk and even go to the bathroom, undress and dress yourself, you are lucky to be able to do that. If you're able to drink and you're able to put it down your throat without even getting somebody to help you, or probably even needing those fluids to go through an IV, you are actually lucky to be able to do that. If you're taking a breath, if you're able to breathe, inhale and exhale, you're lucky to get that breath. And you're lucky to get that because not everybody is getting that. And especially with the different illnesses, we could see how different illnesses can take away all your power and can take away all your energy without you realizing. When we look at energy, we look at health, we look at power, we don't realize the impact it has on our memory because our brain can handle so much. And of course, when our mind is focused on our pain, or focused on different tasks, including the different crisis that we might go in our life, we might actually start losing our ability to focus, to memorize, to do our dhikr, to do the things that we need to do. So having that being said, when we look at ni'matani maghbunun fihuma kathirun min an-nas, as-sihha wal-farag. There are two different blessings. People may not realize, but they're envied for those two blessings, as-sihha wal-farag, health and al-farag, and leisure time, free time. You have these two, then it's, what if somebody says, I don't have the time? We all have the time. It's just an issue of trying to figure out our priorities, trying to put our priorities and then delay or probably even remove a lot of those little things that we might get busy with, and it might take away a lot of our time. Right now, we can do so much. Even when you're probably washing the dishes, you can put those headphones or Bluetooth or whatever it is on your ear, on your to be able to listen to a lecture, even when you're washing the dishes or cooking or cleaning or doing different things. Unlike before, we may not have had the access for these lectures or even the Quran to even listen to. It was only a cassette player, at least in my time, and even before that, they didn't even have that. So when we look at the times that we have today, the privilege that we are living in today, we could definitely make use a lot of our time. Like I said, we have to first recognize, write everything down, and see how much time are you spending on each and every single task, or each and every single thing that you're doing. How much time are you spending in cooking, cleaning, or maybe talking over the phone, or maybe reading a book, or maybe reading a story, a novel, or watching TV? How much time are you spending in your playing, or how much time are you spending on Facebook, or just watching these little short videos? How much time am I spending on those? And then you can see what you need to deduct in order to find the time. It's not that we don't have the time, it's an issue of managing our time. Managing our time to put our priorities in place, because life is short. Somebody might say, I never have any leisure time. The question is, are you looking at your schedule and seeing how much time you are spending on things that in reality, and in the reality of those things that you're doing, they're actually just plain entertainment? How much time am I spending on that? Do I need to reduce any of that? How much can I reduce? Then, and it is only then, you will be able to find time to do more important things. What kind of more important things? Maybe time to raise your children right. Maybe time to tell them about a hadith, an ayah, teach them about akhlaq. And this is something I always say, if your children are listening to you now, you're able to force your children to listen to you by the time they're 19 and 20. Your voice is going to be so common, so normal to them, that most likely they won't even hear your words talking. They'll just become so numb to your voice that they won't even hear you. Say and tell your children the wisdoms, the advice that you would like them to hear now before they're 19 and 20, because the chances are they're going to listen to their friends and their peers than listen to you. Teach it to them now. The other part, time for Quran, memorization. There's nothing like that dhikr. Number three, time and finding time in order to do that talab al-ilm, no matter what kind of a degree you have, no matter how much you studied, in the end, there's always more time to learn, and especially learning your deen. Because learning your deen is actually learning the most important thing about your life, which is the purpose, the essence that you were created for before even your own existence. If we don't understand, if we don't learn what we need to do and what things we need to carry on with us in this dunya and really live as if we are strangers or as if we are passing by, as if we are passing by, if we don't get those instructions, then we're definitely going to get carried away with different sightseeing in this dunya and not realizing the instructions to go for our destination. Remember, there's an itinerary for every single ticket, for every single journey. Nawawi actually put you those itineraries all in the 42 Nawawi Hadith. Put you those itineraries, how to live, and throughout your journey, what you want to do. And in the end, in his itinerary, he said, I'll quote the Prophet, peace be upon him's word, a very short phrase, a very short hadith, be in this dunya, because the journey is actually this dunya. Your itinerary, the most important word that you want to take, motto, you would want to say, in this world that you want to keep, stay in this dunya, on your journey, as if you are a complete stranger. And then, or as if you're just passing by, you've got a certain amount of weight to carry with you. Don't exaggerate in what you want to take, because you're going to leave that behind. And don't exaggerate in what you want to collect, because at the end of the day, even in your life, you would spend so much throughout your life. You would use your health, and you would use your time, and you would use all the effort in order to get money. When you get older, you will start wanting to spend your time, and you'll start spending your money just to get health. So don't waste your health and don't waste your time, because now is the time to take advantage of those two precious things, your time and your health, in order to get to the akhirah. This is the end of this hadith. Next week, inshallah, it's a short hadith, but there's really a lot to say. We usually spend a whole hour, but this hadith is a pretty short hadith. And we'll, inshallah, next week, we'll do hadith number 41. عن أبي محمد عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنهما قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون هواه تبعا لما جئت به. This is a very important hadith. It's going to be a lot to say about this hadith. So stay tuned. I'll be happy to, you can unmute yourselves if you have any questions. I know it's a pretty straightforward hadith and a pretty, not only straightforward, but I would say it's a scary hadith to actually think in this world. We usually think of a journey as something that we're so happy about. We're going, we're excited to sightsee, excited to have good times, excited to see all those different things around us. And subhanAllah, and then you end up realizing that, oh, it with such a short time. And subhanallah, you know, in those unexpected things in your life that come in might actually just remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, you know, in this world and in this dunya, you might want to just take a moment to always do. I know that everybody knows what I said today. Everybody, it's easy, and everybody knows what I said today. In fact, most of you can even do a better job than what I had done to explain this hadith. But we all need this reminder. This reminder is not for you, but this reminder is for myself as well. We all need those moments to remember and take a moment to not get carried away with what we want to do and all those different things that we usually focus on, whether it's a car, degree, marriage, and the list goes on and on. And then we forget, as we focus on those goals, we forget that those are not goals, but those are tools. The goal is the akhirah. The goal is the akhirah, which is really why many sisters or brothers, when they get married, especially sisters, when they get married, they go into depression. This is real. This is really common, that sisters, when they get married, the first 6 months, they go into a moment of depression. And sometimes it might extend for a year, because what the media was portraying about marriage was that it was going to be like the happiest moment ever, and it was going to be as if you're just becoming you know, like the princess, and you're just going to be going into the most beautiful surrounding. And then you realize that, wow, it's really different. I didn't know that it was like this. I don't want to scare sisters away from marriage, but the reality is there's a certain thing that we have to go through. You know, marriage is part of our nature. But subhanAllah, it's really important to keep in mind, it's not just marriage, but it's also when you would think, you would focus, I want to get a house, I want to buy a car, I want to get children, and etc. And then when they get that child, that's why even, you know, for women, I'm not saying that if a woman goes through postpartum depression, that is because she had her hopes up high on a child. I know that there are certain things that are, you know, things that are in their health, and it's not necessarily that she had a low or a bad iman, but sometimes, you know, just to help us feel that when we even get a degree, when we get a child, when we get a degree, when we graduate, etc., they would go into moments of depression, because throughout that time our focus was on, if only I would get a house, if only I would get a degree, if only I would get married, if only I would get to that and that point. Many times we get carried away thinking that that's a destination. If only I get there, I will be the happiest person in the world. But then when they get there, they realize that they didn't really get much. In the end, it's just a tool, but you're really going to be the same. It's just a tool. If only I get a job. And then when you get the job, you're like, oh, I'm tired already. But then in the end, we always have to remind ourselves that this dunya is just passing by, and you're just to be passing by, كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيب, as if you're a stranger. Don't go into those moments of being over hopeful and exaggerate that this is your place of stay. Don't exaggerate, this is not your place of stay. So focus on your priority, which is al-akhirah, which is the hereafter, which is when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you will see, you would live 40, 50 years old, and it feels like if it was yesterday. You would remember it. You would look at those wrinkles, and you could see yourself aging. You could look at, and subhanAllah, you could, those moments that when you look at your hair getting gray, and your face getting the wrinkles and your body not being as strong, all those are just the red flags to tell you you're getting there. But most of the times when we are young, we will always live. When we're young, especially during the ages of probably between age 15, 14, and I would say around 30, that in that age, we usually forget. During that time, we usually forget that there's something to look for, or there's a purpose to await and a purpose to live up to, which is al-akhirah. And we take advantage of our powers, we take advantage of the time, and we forget. And which is why the Prophet ﷺ had actually mentioned سَبْعَةٌ يُظُلُّهُمُ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ, mentioned the seven that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shed his shade on them. And he mentions one, شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ, a young man or a young woman, they grew up in that mindfulness, in where they were always in ibadatillah, in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, always submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because it is so easy to just slip in our focus and take advantage of all our powers, and so easy to think that it's always going to be there. We would look at the elderly and think, it's going to be a long time for me till I get there. And when you don't realize, it's with a snap, as if you are there. And the Prophet ﷺ in the Hadith, he said, dunya is like somebody resting under a tree, taking a nap and getting up. It passes by fast, and a nap is really short because you already had your long sleep. And that's the same thing. Dunya is so short. Dunya, passes by with a snap. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us mindful of our energy, keep us mindful of our time, to make use of it. Make use of it for the sake of akhirah. Jazakumullah khairan, everyone. Allah yarda anku ya Rabbi, and Allah yahfadhku, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that ability and that focus and that realization that our powers are not everlasting, and our energy is not everlasting, and our health is not everlasting, and our money is not everlasting. You have the money now, but you may not have it tomorrow. Make use of those times. Make use of when you have the money now. Make use and donate it for the khair, because in the end, that money will come back to you for those calamities that you might be passing by, you might be coming across without you realizing. Make use of those times to be with your children as well, to teach them haq and teach them the adab and teach them the deen, because once they grow older and you get weaker, they're not going to listen to you the way they're listening to you right now. You can tell them, sit and listen. You can tell them to eat healthy. You can train them, discipline, etc. But in the end, once they grow older, they'll be out of your powers. They'll be out of your authority without you noticing. I'd be happy to listen to anyone that wants to add something. Probably, you know, add something maybe I had said wrong, and or maybe correct me, or maybe give another advice, or maybe say something. You can unmute yourselves if you would like, or I could see there are a number of people that were actually on Facebook as well. Amal Hayati and Rana, and Allah yahfadhku ya Rabbi, and this is Adan al-Maghrib. So I'd be happy to answer any questions even, or if anybody wanted to say something. I'm surprised Sister Zainab is not unmuting herself. So Jazakumullah khairan, everyone, and Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.